Good afternoon. Welcome to the final session of the 2022 Religion and Foreign Policy Program. Congratulations on making it through the day. Most of you are still with us. Thank you for your contributions and your presence. Thank you, Irina, and your team for putting all of this together. And thank you also to the wait staff who's made sure that we've been nourished this whole time. I'm Simranjeet Singh. I'm the executive director for the Aspen Institute's Religion and Society Program. Our focus is ensuring that we advance religious pluralism in our society. And that's a vision where all people, people of faith, people of no faith, have the opportunity to thrive as we live together. By background, I'm a scholar and historian, trained at Harvard and Columbia. I focus on South Asian religions. And I teach currently at Union Seminary, just up the road. I'm also a writer, and my new book comes out this summer with Penguin Random House, and that's The Light We Give, How Sikh Wisdom Can Transform Your Life.
What can transform?
Sorry,
what was the subtitle?
How Sikh Wisdom Can Transform Your Life. And the focus for me is what does personal storytelling look like in terms of giving us all the answers we need to our world today? And I also want to say one other thing in terms of where I'm coming from today. I mean, I'm literally coming from up the road. I live on 72nd Street, so that's one place I'm coming from today. But I'm also with the Council on Foreign Relations. I'm a term member and on the advisory committee for the Religion and Policy Program. So on behalf of the committee, thank you all for your work in the world in addition to what you're doing today. I wish I was the star of today's session, but that distinction belongs to Dr. Haas here, who needs little introduction in his own home, but we will give him a brief one. Dr. Haas is coming up on 20 years of service as the president of the Council on Foreign Relations. He's the author, editor. He's the author or editor of 14 books. His latest, which I had written down and should remember off the top of my head because I teach it, is also with Penguin Random House. It is The World.
A brief introduction.
A brief introduction. So, and a brief title. So Dr. Richard Haas is here to share with us some of what he is seeing around the world today, particularly with regard to the topic that we are most interested in, and that is religion. And so the place I want to begin is a place where I haven't actually seen anyone begin in a conversation on this stage, and that is by asking you how you're doing.
I can give you a tactical answer or a strategic answer. The tactical answer, good and not so good. Good, I literally about 10 minutes ago mailed off the final draft of my next book. And as anyone who has written a book can tell you, this is now what I call the, when you write a book, it's the storm before the calm. So the writing phase is over, comes out in January. It's an interesting book for me, at least. You have to be interested in your own books so you can't finish them, is because it's the first time I've written a book about domestic policy. It's a book about American democracy, and the reason is people always ask me when I give talks, what's the biggest threat? Is it China or Russia, or North Korea, or Iran, or terrorism, climate change, what have you? And I said, yeah, those are all pretty big threats, but the biggest threat is us. And if this society can't hold together, we're not going to be in any position to contend with any of those threats. Certainly won't be able to contend with them successfully. So I decided, since I kept saying that, I might as well write a book about it. How we got to this point, more important, what I think we need to do to dig ourselves out of this. So I'm in a very good mood because I just finished that. I'm in a not so good mood because I literally was, last night in Washington, we had all six members of the Joint Chiefs of Staff at the Council in Washington. It's an amazing setting. And the six generals, an admiral sit there. And I was doing a conversation with them. And afterwards, I took the last flight back here. So we pulled back from the gate. And we go out, and I fell asleep. And then suddenly we're back at the gate. And I said to myself, well, that's a quick flight. That was great. I slept through the whole thing, except we never left Washington. It turned out Delta ran out of space at LaGuardia, so they wouldn't let us take off. So we then sat there for about 2 hours. Then we, after a conversation, took off for Kennedy, JFK. But then halfway there in the air, the pilot basically called an audible, and we got to land in LaGuardia after all, just a few hours late. And then I had to get up at 5:30 for a meeting this morning because I was meant to be in Europe this week but couldn't for various reasons, including this and last night and a meeting tomorrow. So I'm tired. So those are the tactical. In the larger sense, so every Friday night, I'm of the Jewish faith. And for me, one of the great ways to end the week, I actually think that whether you're Jewish or not, the concept of Shabbat, the Sabbath, is one of the world's greatest inventions. The idea that you take a time out to pause, to stop doing what we all do all the time, and to be with, whether it's in, you know, for me, it's in synagogue for about an hour and 15 minutes that night, or be with, have a nice dinner afterwards with family and friends. So I've become very good friends. Is Elliot here? Elliot Cosgrove or not? My rabbi? Ah, see, I go to his services. He should go to mine. I just want to make this clear. You're all witnesses. But Elliot's the sensational rabbi at Park Avenue Synagogue. And this is a 10-second aside. If you ever want to, if you haven't experienced a Jewish service, between Elliot's sermons and the cantor there, Ozzie Schwartz, who when God was giving out golden voices, basically had some left over and gave him extra. It really is, intellectually and musically, as wonderful a service on Friday nights as you get. And Elliot came up to me, Rabbi Cosgrove, and said, how you doing? And he said, you know, given, he said, like, I know he reads my stuff on Russia, Ukraine, all that. He said, see, you're dealing with all this stuff all the time. He said, does anyone ever stop and give you any pastoral support? And I said, well, thanks for mentioning it, but that's why I come here, and I get the support I need. And I don't get discouraged or depressed by what I do. I actually get motivated. I feel it's important and it's relevant. So it's a long way of saying I am doing fine. I am worried about what's going on in the country. I'm worried about what's going on in the world. But I wake up every morning, I think if one feels, one, healthy, and two, purposeful, it doesn't get much better than that.
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the observations that I've made in my interactions with CFR has been something seems to be changing. And that's something, if we can put a finger on it, and Dr. Ramakrishnan this morning pointed to this. He said, you know, historically, religion has not been a serious consideration when it comes to foreign policy. And that, I think, has also been true here at the Council for the longest time. But when you joined, you decided to put together a program where we really took religion seriously. And I'd love to hear some reflection from you on why that was, what the intervention was that you thought needed to be made, and how that seems to have been playing out.
Well, I feel like my answer should be, since you used the word intervention, it was divine intervention, which led me to
there
do it,
go.
But it wasn't. I can't remember where it was. Actually, there's a couple of things. One, a little bit of biography here. I was a religion major originally in college. I was at Oberlin. And I went around and I said to my friends, I didn't know what I wanted to study. I was a typically undirected young person. And indeed, I was always nervous by people who knew, like from the age of 15, they wanted to be a right shoulder surgeon. That kind of specificity always really unnerved me. I never understood that, but I digress. And I went to people and said, who's the best professor on campus? And they said, it's Professor Frank, Professor Tom Frank. And I said, that's great. What does he do? What does he teach? And they said, New Testament. And I said, we never got around to that one in my house. But I'm game. Bring it on. It was fantastic. It was actually, if you ever needed a lesson that a good teacher can make anything fantastic. And because of him, I then went off to the Middle East. It was the summer after, I think, my sophomore year. So this is 1971. Spent the summer working on an archaeological dig. Then spent my junior year abroad in Israel, traveled all over the Middle East, and essentially ended up getting my degree finally in modern Middle Eastern studies. So my background had a lot of comparative religion at Oberlin. And I should just say, subsequently in my career, it was a fantastic advantage. I was President Bush the Father's Middle East and Persian Gulf and South Asian advisor at the White House. Well, how could you possibly deal with the challenges in that part of the world without understanding what was, in many ways, the principal driver of culture and societies? So I think people who had narrow political science-type backgrounds or economics backgrounds were, they didn't have a lot of the tool set they needed. So I thought, if you're interested in international relations and you want to understand other societies, I would just argue you are advantaged if you have that. In my own writings, it's had a big influence. When I wrote a book called War of Necessity, War of Choice, about the two Iraq wars, the Gulf War being the war of necessity, I argued the 2003 Iraq War being the war of choice, that concept of wars of necessity, wars of choice was not original. There was this guy, Maimonides, a great medieval Jewish thinker, who talked about wars the king had to fight, was obligated to fight, and wars the king did not. It had very different criteria, and I found it a really useful approach. And then soon after I got here, it must have been like maybe 15 years ago, a couple years after I got here, I was reading somewhere, and I can't remember the statistic now, but a stunning percentage of Americans once a week went to a house of worship. Well over 150 million Americans out of roughly, at that point, say a society of 300 million Americans. Now, it didn't get into the details of what percentage of them stayed awake during the sermons, but on the off chance that it was a fairly high percentage. And I said, wow, what an amazing thing. So you all, people who are religious and congregational leaders, I thought had an ability to reach a swath of Americans who, quite honestly, are not necessarily reading Foreign Affairs magazine as good as it is. And it was part and parcel of a much larger change we made to this organization. We're 100 years old, elite, I guess is the word I'd use, or establishment. And one of the things we did about 10, 15 years ago was say, we're going to continue doing all the stuff we've always done, hopefully better and so forth, but we've got to find ways of reaching a much larger chunk of Americans. And we started special programs for high school and college, now middle school kids. We've done it for journalists who are local all over the country, for governors and mayors and people who are not normally part of the foreign policy conversation, and people such as yourselves, religious and congregational leaders. And it was a way to reach you and through you to reach others, to get people interested on the almost Jefferson's idea that we want informed citizens, but also to hear from you. You are in touch with all these people. You were reaching Americans every day that we would never come into contact with. So I thought you would also be a great teacher and resource for us. So that's how it happened. It was really pragmatic. And I actually think it's one of the best things we've done. Sort of getting, just broadening the conversation. And you all have been great participants in this conversation.
I want to ask you about a key pressing issue. And that's religious freedom. Its meaning is contentious.
Sure.
Its implementation is contested. Some say that it is it's a tool that is weaponized. Mm-hmm. And I would be interested to hear your perspective on how this discourse and its application playing out both in the U.S. and abroad.
It's a big question, an important question. Look, in this country, and you got at it in your introductory remarks, we've always believed in freedom of religion and freedom from religion. You can practice whatever faith however you want, and you can practice not having a faith if that's what you want. And the Constitution's pretty clear about the non-establishment of religion. In that sense, we're very different from many other countries. So, and I think the challenge for us is to keep it that way. And interestingly enough, the statistics show that America is becoming much less religious. The secularization of America is really an interesting phenomenon, and all sorts of things, not necessarily healthy, flow from it. But we're also, at the same time, becoming, in pockets of America, intensely religious as part of our larger sense of this country is, in many cases, rather than a melting pot, not even a mixing pot, is just separate pots. And we're seeing that. So I think at the same time, we're having pockets of intensification of religion, often one religion, based upon the locality. At the same time, the overall trends in the society are moving away from religion. There's actually been I think Fareed Zakaria wrote about it a couple of weeks ago in his column. The statistics, there's a new book recently came out. Sorry, I can't remember the name of the author on this. We can get the name of it, Arena, afterwards to people. But about the rather rapid secularization, if you will, of it, because we went from being one of the most religious countries, certainly in the developed world and the quote-unquote Western world, to now we've kind of joined the pack, which is quite interesting as to why and what are the consequences. I think in a lot of the world now, there's less freedom of religion, because it's seen as religion is a source of independence. It's a sort of independent authority, independent loyalties and affiliations. And in big chunks of the world, that's unacceptable. If you won't allow people to act economically, because people who have economic independence might be somewhat then free of the powers of the state, or might want to translate some of that economic power into political independence, same thing goes for religion. And authoritarian figures historically have always been suspicious, fearful even. You know, so yeah, how many divisions does the Pope have? Well, in many cases, the Pope has quite a few. And I thought it was, shall we say, no accident what happened in Hong Kong the other day. Xi Jinping has obviously tried to clamp down, and your whole original clamp down on Hong Kong was to clamp down on the virus, quote unquote, as he saw it. And I don't mean COVID. I mean the political virus of liberalism and separatism. And religious authority represents a form of independence. Now we've seen in Russia, almost the opposite. I mean, with Putin, yes, clamping down, but the behavior of the leadership there, I think, has been extraordinarily unfortunate. I don't mean to offend anybody if I'm offending anybody, but it really is. Unfortunate is a delicate word. But I think in general, if one looks at Freedom House, over the last two decades, there's been a recession, a backsliding in terms of our freedom, measurements of freedom and democracy in the world, religion and repression. We saw it obviously with the Rohingya. At some point, religion and culture and societies are intermingled. But I think in general, there's been greater repression, greater intolerance around, and times of stress bring it out. COVID's been a time of stress, economic problems are times of stress. Social media tends to be a real divider and an accelerator of these things. So yeah, I think it's been a bad two decades for, if you will, classic liberalism. And even modern day liberalism isn't always liberal. So it's in the classic sense. So I think it's been a rough time in terms of religious freedom. I wish I could say I thought it was bottoming out, but I don't think we're there yet. Sorry, I'm the most depressing person you will ever interact with, and I apologize. I apologize for that in advance. I have much to ask forgiveness for. As a result, you'll be glad to know.
Well, I'll ask forgiveness too, because I have a follow-up question. So, I don't think the emergence, or at least the ascent of religious nationalism, is unrelated. I think it's directly tied to some of these religious freedom issues we're seeing. Mm-hmm. And we can look around the world and point to Myanmar, India. We just had a large conversation about Afghanistan.
Sure.
No religious community seems to be exempt from this challenge, right? We're talking about Buddhists, Muslims, Hindus across the board.
You're right.
And also, I think one element of this issue that's become apparent to us is we no longer have the luxury of pointing our fingers elsewhere only and saying, you guys are doing it wrong. I mean, the rise of and you know, the growth of Christian nationalism here has really created a crisis in this country that we can no longer avoid. And so I'd love to hear you speak for a moment about the role of religion in fueling some of the most difficult crises in our time today.
Well, the answer is it does. I mean, I worry about, in some ways, Hindu nationalism in India. I mean, India was born as a secular country, and indeed it resisted the creation of Pakistan because it said Muslims in India do not need to find a sanctuary country of their own. We are a tolerant, secular country. Jinnah and, you know, hundreds of millions or tens of millions at that point of Muslims disagreed and formed their own country. And now here we are, what, three quarters of a century later nearly, and India is becoming more of a Hindu country, and you've got over 200 million Indian Muslims. And the question is, what does this mean, not just for those individuals, but what does this mean for the fabric of Indian society? What does it mean for India's relationship with Pakistan, which, shall we say, doesn't need much additional kindling on the... So there's that. See, I worry about that kind of... look, it's part and parcel of a larger phenomenon. You could talk about religion, but in many ways, the popular... If you think of a religion, not just as something that is a religious force, but as an identity type thing, the idea that it would become slightly more assertive, slightly less tolerant, accepting of others, well, that's kind of where we are with populism. That's where we are, if you will, in my arena, in the political arena. So it's not surprising to me that we're seeing it more and more countries, and we're often seeing governments, for whatever reason, mobilizing public opinion in favor of X or against Y. And I think that's been the trend. I mean, you know, what's going on in Afghanistan, since you mentioned that. Yeah, I mean, the Taliban obviously, you know, represent a fairly, I would say, extreme or radical strand. It's disappointing, but not surprising what's going on there. To me, it was pretty predictable based upon my own experience with Afghanistan. Again, it becomes a form of identity and social mobilization, and particularly for those who are the most, active defenders of a system or a regime. Religion becomes a mobilizing force, and the problem is, by definition, then it becomes illiberal. It becomes intolerant of those who don't, one way or another, get with the plan. And it becomes also a matter of identity. And matters of identity are inherently intolerant. By the time you get to matters of identity, how do you compromise? Almost by definition, identity doesn't lend itself very neatly to compromise. And religion can fuel that. And we're seeing that around the world. So you have interesting things. You have kind of the mobilization of religion in a place like Afghanistan or India. And then in places like China, authoritarian system like that, you have the repression of religion, because it's competition, to put it bluntly. It's a competing affiliation, a competing loyalty. It's a competing belief system. If you're trying to spread the notion that President Xi's thought is an all-purpose explanation and is all you need to make sense of life, then a religion's just competition. So there's not a lot of place for it. So we're seeing all of this. I say one other thing. I think in this country it's different. It's neither of those in some ways. But I think also that religion does become part of identity. And it becomes, when people are feeling fearful or confused, religion can be, which is fine, and I'm respectful of it, and being devout is great, unless it becomes, if you will, zero sum, and then that someone else is gonna pay a price for it. If you choose to live your life in an orthodox manner, a devout manner, you know, so be it. It's your choice, and that's part of freedom of religion to do that. Mm-hmm. But when it comes at the expense of others, then it's something very different.
Yeah. So bringing it home a little bit, I think given how apparent it's become that you know these issues of religious nationalism, religious freedom are our problems as much as they are the world's problems. How do you see that affecting the effectiveness that the U.S. has in claiming or advocating or even attempting intervention abroad? Clearly there's some level of hypocrisy there, but what's the right balance in terms of focusing inward, engaging outward? Do we do both at the same time? What does that look like?
Well, I'd say before I even got to that, I'd say one has to be aware of it simply as a phenomena. And when you're dealing with other societies in which religion's a powerful engine or definer, a driver of dynamics, then you better take it into account. It's just a fact of life. I don't care if you like it or loathe it, it's just there. And if you ignore it or underestimate it, at your peril. And in places like Afghanistan or some places in the Middle East or what have you, you just got to take it into account. You know, with secular societies, you don't have too much. But you just got to think about it. Look, I think our ability, I'd say I'd actually broaden it beyond religion. Our ability to cope successfully with our own differences, with our own challenges, has two great virtues. One is that, by definition, it doesn't then divide us. We're then in a much better position to meet the inbox of challenges we face. And second of all, we can, you know, I've often thought the most important thing we do in terms of many issues is not what we say or do, it's what we are. And we represent a successful model of how a society can and should be organized when we're at our best. And that's true in the economic sphere, it's true in the political sphere, it's true in the social sphere. And if we can be tolerant, respectful, essentially, you know, we're a rare heterogeneous society. You know, what's so unique about, one of the things I've done in the course of writing this book I just finished, is I went back and either reread stuff I hadn't read or read it for the first time. And it's so interesting to go back to a lot of the founding materials and the rest, and you do realize how much this is a country unlike almost any other, and that we were based upon and founded on an idea. And we have been varied in many ways from the get-go, and because of immigration and so forth, we've become even more varied over time. But you look at even other democracies. You look at the Japans of the world, or many democracies in Latin America or in Europe. Short of recent immigration, much more homogeneous societies. This has not been a homogeneous society in terms of race, in terms of religion, in terms of ethnic or national background, so it's only worked when the fabric was inherently one of, if you will, classic liberalism, tolerance, diversity, whatever words you... And I think when we get it right, it sends a great message to the rest of the world. And when we get it wrong, it sends just the opposite. Actually, I mean, it's hard for me to know what's cause and effect, but the fact that there's been backsliding in the world in terms of freedoms and democracy, I can't decide at times that we're a reflection of that and just kind of one of many examples, or to some extent, we're one of the causes of that. Because we've had a deterioration here, we're no longer in a position, shall we say, to be the shining city on a hill. It's going to take a long time before we can get back to the top of that hill. Hopefully we'll get there, but we got a ways to climb.
Yeah, it's a humbling perspective, I think, and it keeps things in perspective for us too, that you know we are the most religiously diverse society in human history in this country, most racially diverse. I mean, some of these challenges, I mean, if we step back from where we are today, which can be hard to do, they seem unavoidable, that these tensions will be there. And perhaps you have a reaction to that.
Well, I don't know. I mean, yeah, I think differences to some extent provoke tensions, but with one great exception, in the middle of the 19th century, at the time of the Civil War, we've been able pretty well to deal with some of our fundamental tensions. And that's been for nearly 2.5 centuries now. And the question is, though, going forward, will we be as successful? And Churchill's old line, Americans can be trusted to do the right thing, but only after they've tried everything else. It's a kind of sanguine take And my view is, well, maybe. But, you know, we're older, and as we've seen in ourselves, as you get older, the arteries get harder. Social systems can become sclerotic, as well as physical systems. And there are some fundamental different phenomena that are affecting democracy. As I mentioned, social media. Before, there's much less a sense of community in the United States now, much less common experience. We are much more divided geographically. There's not just less social mobility, there's less physical mobility. There's a sorting, S-O-R-T-I-N-G, in America, where people are increasingly living with like-minded, including like-minded religiously. So this is much, we are a country that's founded on an idea, but one, increasingly we don't know what, we've lost sight of what those ideas were. We certainly don't teach them in our schools. You're hard-pressed often to find serious civics education. Indeed, just to give a 10-second digression here, there's, various bills before Congress to promote the teaching of civics, which is great, except there's a sentence in the bill that says there cannot be, nothing in this bill should be construed as advocating a single national civics curriculum. And I'm sitting there going, man, is that my definition of preposterous? The idea that a kid in a classroom in Arkansas in the United States of America should learn different national civics education than a kid in Iowa or California or New York. Last I checked, we only had one constitution. I could see why you might want to learn a little bit about state history, but I worry about some of this, but now I've forgotten what you asked me. I've gone on so long. So I've gotten lost in my own words. I apologize.
No, that's great. I appreciate the anecdote and the insight. And one last question before we turn it over to the group for their questions, and that is, what do you, sitting from where you are, and seeing the world in the way that you do, what do you anticipate in the next 5 to 10 years as being some of the greatest religion-related challenges in the world?
You would be so much better able to to answer your own question than I would. I haven't thought of it. Quite honestly, I haven't thought about, to me, the biggest challenges are not directly religious so much as what religious leaders, example, if you said climate change was one of the greatest challenges the world's going to face, to me the question is, what are religious, since God created the heavens and the earth, what are religious leaders going to do in order to galvanize action in order to protect the heavens and the earth, or where they see the kinds of intolerance we've been discussing within societies, what are religious leaders going to do? Are they going to, if you will, go with the flow, or are they going to resist the flow where they believe it's inconsistent with the tenets of what their religion teaches? Are they, are they going to put nationalism before classic liberalism? But I think the challenges in the world are going to be enormous. You've got the rise of geopolitics all over, which is going to create pressures on religious leaders to toe certain lines. We've had the reintroduction of conflict. There was this enormous literature in the field about how conflict between countries had become obsolete. We didn't need to worry about it anymore. Not so much. Nuclear weapons have kind of received a new boost in importance. So we're going to have to deal with the consequences of that. And then we've got all the global challenges. So it was COVID-19. So who's to say there won't be COVID-23 or COVID-24 or COVID-25 or some other infectious disease? And the only thing we know is the world failed to deal adequately with COVID-19. And I don't see the machinery or the policies in place to deal successfully. Indeed, what makes it really frustrating is we had the technological breakthrough of the mRNA vaccines, and despite that, we didn't deal successfully with it. The big chunks of the world remain without the sort of vaccination or access to therapeutic drugs that they deserve. So you've got geopolitics, you've got the global, and you've got the internal challenges in a lot of the countries of the world. You could have major political transitions in this country. We'll see what happens in 24. in Russia. We'll see what happens there over coming days, weeks, months, and years in China. So Mr. Xi will almost certainly get his third term, but well, you know, there's now increasing signs of pushback in China because in part of the mishandling of COVID, because of the economic slowdown, his siding with Russia during this crisis. So we'll see what happens there. And at some point, whether it's in, you know, 5 years, whatever, 10, you know, at some point there'll be successions. And the one thing we know about authoritarian systems is that they ain't good on successions, transitions, because there's no legitimate transfer of power. We didn't used to have to worry about it in this country, but now we have to worry about that too. So all I'm saying is there's tremendous, so I don't think of it in narrow religious terms, but all of these things will potentially either pose difficult decisions for religious and spiritual leaders, or will create difficult conditions for them. Now, I could be too negative and there could be wonderful things and all that. If that happens, great. You know, I'd love to, you know. But my sense is it's going to be a difficult era of period of international relations, just given the trends that are afoot.
Thank you. At this time, I'd invite members of the audience. If you have questions, please raise your hand. Members who are zooming in from home or their offices, you're invited as well. I have a question over here. If you'd remind us your name and your affiliation, please.
Jim Gilchrist, I teach religion courses at Carnegie Mellon. First of all, I've been here every year since 2007. I want to thank you for this. This is the best thing of its kind going on in the country. So thanks so much for this opportunity. I teach religion courses at a university that's very techie, right? Carnegie Mellon's one of the leading universities in the world with regard to science and technology and artificial intelligence and so forth. Every year we have about 60 students sign up for this Intro to Religion course, and 70% of them are not religious at all, but they have not much idea about religion, most of them, and what ideas they do have are not very positive. So we talk about religious people behaving badly and acknowledge all that, but then we point out how many world-class scientists have in fact been religious over the centuries. We talk about civil rights and we read Laudato Si and all of this. And the reaction is often, really, I had no idea. And in their techie world, if the best they could hope for is Elon Musk colonizing Mars or Mark Zuckerberg's metaverse, they seem to want to know, isn't there more than this? So my question for you is, do you think it's possible that if young people particularly who don't know much about religion and what little they think they know about it is bad, if they saw religious bodies acting conspicuously around the kinds of things that we've been talking about here for 15 years, racial issues, gender issues, stewardship of the environment, overcoming poverty and injustice in various ways, do you think it's possible that these kinds of initiatives might actually lead to a bit of a religion revival? Because if people started to see religion identify with the kinds of things that I saw it identify when I was a kid, they might actually find it appealing in ways that they don't now because they just don't know.
I'm not sure what I think. I can see why you might think yes, because it would check the relevant box. Oh yeah, religion is relevant. And if you agreed with the political agenda, you would say, wow, not only is it relevant, but it's out there doing what I consider to be the right thing. So that would be tempting. The problem would be is that there isn't agreement on what the right thing is. So rather than religion being a kind of safe space where those of us who disagree in politics could nevertheless gather, then religion becomes another set of boxes where we then gravitate towards that preacher or that church or that synagogue or that mosque or that whatever, where we've kind of siloed with other like minds, which is, by the way, what's happening in big parts of the country. You're seeing it in the evangelical church, by the way. You know, as several, you know, those of you there who come from that world know. And the last thing we need are more things that divide us. So I kind of like the idea. I haven't thought it through. It's a really interesting question. So now I'm going to mull it. And I'm giving a long-winded answer because I'm thinking about it as I speak to your question. Always a dangerous thing to do. But I kind of like the idea of sanctuaries being a sanctuary. And it seems to me where I would emphasize, and I've thought about it in the course of writing this book I've just written, is thinking less about what the policy is and more about the practice. It's how we go about the pursuit of our political agendas, whatever they may be. So whether you think climate change is this or that, or you think that this on abortion, whatever your public policy stance is on this or that issue, where I think religious and congregational leaders can do the best work is not on saying this is quote unquote the right answer, but rather this is the right way to go about both figuring out what you believe in and then pursuing it. And that, I think, you get into tolerance, civility, nonviolence, and so forth. That, to me, is where religious leaders can make a difference. Once they start choosing up sides and say, this, you know, viability is a 22 weeks rather than 23 weeks, well, then religious leaders are like political leaders. We already got a lot of those. We don't have a lot of respect for them. So I'd be wary. Okay, now I got my answer. I knew if I talked long enough, I'd have my answer. I would be wary about a policy-centered, defined approach for making religion relevant. I'd be much more focused on the behaviors and what are the teachings about how we go about, if you will, our secular life.
Thank you. Over back here, Guthrie.
Graves Fitzsimmons with the Baptist Joint Committee for Religious Liberty. And I'm wondering, do you think the U.S. government foreign policy agencies have the tools they need to engage religious communities and understand the role of religion around the world?
I think you should answer that. Seriously. The answer is, I don't really know. And, you know, when I was in government, I've worked at the Pentagon, the State Department, the White House. This was not what I did, you know, 99% of the time. And the people who were off doing things were kind of separate. And that might be a problem, that the fact that it wasn't mainstream. The danger whenever you create special offices is you think you're promoting the importance of an issue, and often you're sidelining it. And my guess is when you have all these ambassadors, so for special purposes, one of which is, you know, this or that on religious-related freedoms, rights, pursuits, I would much rather have it be mainstream, so the average assistant secretary or undersecretary or whatever promoted it in his or her job, integrating it with other things, rather than having it be sidelined. What do you think about that? You thought about it much more systematically than I have.
Oh, I mean, it's exactly the same. I don't think much has seemed to have changed since the time you spent there. It is absolutely the case that religion, and I think those of you in this room would probably have experienced this in various ways. Religion, for many reasons, including the fact that people don't understand it, the fact that we don't know how to talk about it in a public way, that we're fearful of, and I think rightfully so, but we haven't quite figured out how to walk this line of church and state. Religion is consistently out of the picture, and its engagement in a foreign policy context requires these special offices or these advocacy organizations or these UN bodies to come in and assist or support, but it's never central, it's never integrated. And I think, you know, the other sort of element of that experience is too often in these contexts, our political leaders, it's not that they need to be experts on religion. As you were saying, you don't need to specialize in religion in order to lead in a country like ours, but you should know how to deal with it. And you should know how to talk to communities just like you know how to talk to every other community. And so I think that's the real danger that I'm seeing in our context right now. But thank you. We'll take another question over here, please.
Thank you. Honestly, I think kind of overthinking all of this. And Professor, I would just change around two words. You said religious bodies. I think the answer, the better approach might be bodies that happen to be religious. Meaning the bottom line is that if people of faith want to influence the general society or even their own flock, lead by example. Okay? If people are hungry, we can all give the same speech. But yeah, I think this is less about finding new experts to teach us about how to communicate. I think you probably see that at the beginning of every semester with those 60 or so students. At the end of the day, I found, you know, as a rabbi also born in Brooklyn and who also loves Friday night, I know that I have many enemies who can't wait for Friday night because they know we can't say anything about them for 25 hours. And if it's in Asia, it's 30 plus hours. But I think the people of faith who feel in their gut that they can and should be making a difference in society should do so by leading by example. When they show that kind of difference, they're going to inspire curiosity, and you go from there. But the notion, and I know it's kind of maybe blasphemous at this kind of a setting, you know, we talk about groups and councils and analysis. You know, if you do good, you're going to attract people. If you stay irrelevant in our kind of world, and I think we haven't really come fully to grips with the power of social media to deconstruct everything. The whole sense of community is just fractionating across the board. Anyway, do good.
Look, I actually want to now amend my answer, because here I am thinking. It's good. It's amazing what you learn when you listen. So one thinks about religious leaders who took an active role in the civil rights movement. And at various times against war, you know, because they felt that essentially the precepts of their religion in terms of, so I guess what I'd say, and I have to think, I don't know what the criteria would be, but there clearly is a place of what you asked about the role of religion, in, if you will, in the political space. And I think, if things are important enough, it's hard to say why, to what I said, I think the emphasis should be on behaviors, which I think is probably still true, because religion then can be a moderating force. On certain issues, you're never going to reach agreement. But there are those times where you'd say this is such a powerful issue. It could be climate change for some. I suppose it could be one side or the other side of the abortion debate for others. It could be matters of war and peace for still others. Those are where religious values are so in play that it'd be an act of a sin of omission not to be involved. Indeed, on the Jewish holy day of Yom Kippur, after you basically ask forgiveness for all the sins of commission, the last one is you ask forgiveness for the sin of inaction and omission, where you stand aside and mobilized when you should get involved. And I've often thought about that. And I just think but involvement then places a special, because it's got added implications. And again, it could be the sort of thing that, you know, potentially splits congregations or whatever. But there are times when to stand aloof is just as much of a moral choice and a political choice as to get involved. So I amend my earlier answer, but I think one has to go about it with great care and caution, but there are times when I think there is things are either stark enough or important enough when the option of if you will, standing aside is just as much of a political decision and may not be the right one.
I'm going to take a question from our online audience.
Our next online question will be from Azakara.
First of all, thank you very much indeed. I've thoroughly enjoyed today's presentations, and thank you so much for this particular panel that brings so much together. A couple of points. As somebody who's been working in the area of intersection between religions and public policy in governmental, non-governmental, and intergovernmental settings, I think we should just take into account a few things, just keep them at the back of our mind. Number one, there is no such thing as religion. There are multiple religions. There's no one religion. So when we keep talking about religion, and we tend to simplify, and that's an erroneous problem and can create some rather egregious violations. Number two, I think we are way beyond the civil rights movement where we learn from it. But I think what we've heard today points to the fact that we need to be considering not just religion or religions, but perhaps the multi-religious intersectionality with various public policy and certainly with foreign policy decisions. The multi-religious, and I ask you here to understand what I'm trying to say by just imagining for a moment what the debate on abortion in the United States of America would look like if it was not just listening to the various Christian articulations thereof and positions on it, but listening to what different religions working together might actually have to say about the whole issue. Just having that knowledge at the back of our mind, I think, would strategically transform much of how this kind of articulation in the foreign space, sorry, in the public space in the US might look like. So the multi-religious is something that I don't think we are very literate about. And we should start talking about multi-religious literacy rather than just literacy of a religious space. The third and my last point is completely to concur with what has been said by Richard and the moderator. Thank you so far. Is that what we need to do is not make a big fuss about religions and not to assume at the same time that it is not part of what's going on. I think if we look at the interaction between the Kirill, Patriarch Kirill and Mr. and President Putin, we would realize that far from religion not really being part of the foreign policy, it is very much a determinant thereof. And I would remind us that we spoke and we still do about just war before the invasion of Iraq. And that was a concept developed by certain religious actors and elements. So the notion that religions aren't involved enough, are not really impacting, with all due respect, if we look at the rest of the world, including this country, that notion is erroneous at best. And it leads to a lot of ignorance in the way that we look at religions. So maybe we should start to be a bit more pragmatic about how religions are already influencing the public space and foreign policy in particular, because that understanding might help us evolve a much more nuanced approach to what we mean. Thank you.
The only thing I'd say is, thank you for that, is that there's a difference between a religious leader using religion to justify a foreign policy choice as opposed to taking religious values and ethics and shaping a foreign policy choice and helping secular leaders think through. And what we're seeing in Russia is the former. We're seeing religion being used to justify a deeply flawed and misguided foreign policy choice. Indeed, if religious precepts had ever been applied by Mr. Putin, this war never would have been launched. And I think that's sort of the basic point here.
Thank you. We have a question up front.
There's one in the back, I think.
Thank you. Then one back there next. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm David Greenhaw. As of a week ago, I started as the senior minister of a church in Naples, Florida, so who knows. I wanted to, it seems to me that one of the major roles that religion plays is the ability to imagine. Imagine that things might be really other than they are. One of the problems I have with Ukraine right now is I can't imagine how the heck this will stop and where it'll go. Because you, if I'm remembering correctly, spent time in Northern Ireland and were involved in that, and that's sufficiently long ago that things have changed, did you ever imagine then that it would look like it does today? And if so, how? And if not, are you more encouraged or less? And can you wax on the role of imagination?
Just 20 seconds before I get to Northern Ireland, one of the reasons you may find it difficult to imagine how the war ends is it may not. Yeah. And the war, people forget that Mr. Putin pursued a war in the Donbas for 8 years, from 2014 until this February, before he expanded the war. And my own view, I hope I'm wrong, good news is I'm wrong a lot. I think it might be less difficult for him politically to simply continue this war than it would be to try to stop it. Because if he stops it, and he tried to formally stop it, he would have to agree to Ukraine's separate status. He would have to accept certain limits on Russia's position. And so I don't see him doing that. So I think the most likely scenario is a open-ended, frozen, whatever you want to call it, conflict. Northern Ireland, I got involved roughly 20 years ago when I was the U.S. envoy from 2001 to 2003. And then I got involved again about almost 10 years ago now, when I was brought in by the leadership of Northern Ireland itself to help them deal with some of their challenges, the most interesting one of which was one that is common to many societies, including this one, but virtually every society around the world, which is how to deal with its own past and the struggle of societies to come to terms with their own legacies is a really, really difficult one. And Northern Ireland still hasn't done it. So we gave them a roadmap for doing it, the British government just announced about a week ago, a revival of it using many of the things we proposed, but it still hasn't happened. So in that, it's still very divided. Interesting enough, here when we talk about integrated schools in this country, you know, we obviously talk about it usually in terms of color. In Northern Ireland, integrated education is religious. It's denominational. So when you speak about the integrated education movement, you're talking basically about where Protestant and Catholic young, you know, kids go to school. The society, though, is so divided that it's still less than 10%. It's a relatively small. You've had slight demographic changes. You know, Brexit was the big surprise, and that changed the dynamic. To me, the most interesting thing, which I didn't quite see, but actually see it's potentially heartening, is on the growth of the center. What happened in the elections the other day in Northern Ireland, for those of you who don't pay, you know, is that Sinn Féin, so-called Republican Party, their version of the word, not ours, got the most seats, got a plurality. The unionist parties got more, but they were divided. But what was interesting was the strength of the center, the alliance that it's called. And so you've got some changing dynamics, in part for demographic changes, experiential changes, and then because of Brexit. I don't think Irish unification or anything like it is going to happen anytime soon. I'm not sure you're going to have the standing up of local institutions anytime soon. What I hope we don't have is a revival of violence. And what it's interesting, if you don't, one of the things that worries me a little bit about Northern Ireland, since you don't teach the past very well, I worry that a whole generation is coming of age and doesn't know about the troubles. One of the things I try to do, one of my many unsuccessful things there, is I tried to get established a museum of the history of the troubles. I wanted there to be a place where young people in Northern Ireland of all denominations, traditions could go to learn about their own past, not to teach one narrative, but to teach, here's the basic facts and here's the varying interpretations, the competing narratives. And like I said, it was one of the many, many areas I failed in getting to where I wanted. So I think at the moment, it's the biggest problem is probably drift, which discourages certain types of economic investment and the rest. What'll be interesting is if we ever get to the point where large scale or wholesale political change is possible, which would mean unification with Ireland, how that's accepted by the population, and would that become an occasion of violence, in this case, from the unionist side, or what's called the loyalist side when it uses violence. And that's, I don't know the answer to that question. I hope not, but I fear there's some possibility. And even small numbers of people, as we've learned, very small numbers of groups in a democratic society can cause outsized problems. But we'll see.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Haas, for your time today. I see we're coming to the end, so apologies that we didn't get to everyone's questions. We hear from Dr. Haas often, so if you're involved next year, you'll get to hear from him again, hopefully in between, join the
program.
Hopefully
next year this guy Haas will be much more positive and optimistic. Because this is a downer to end your day with us. But again, thank you. Thank you all for giving us your time and your interest. And thank you for what you do. When I look around and I look at this society, I think you're all individuals of extraordinary influence and importance. So thank you for what you do. And if we can be a resource in any way, Marina and her team are here quite literally in her case, if not 24/7, maybe 22/7. And we allow her 2 hours a day for a cat nap. So if we can be healthy, if you have ideas about things we can be doing the rest of the year, let us know. If you have ideas about ways we can make these types of meetings better, let us know. But in the meantime, Irina, thank you and your gang for all that you do. And thank you all for coming here.